Satellite navigation is hugely important in today's warfare. All big nations use their own satellite navigation constellations, jamming the signal coming into the final user's receiver, say in a plane, in a tank, or in a missile. That can be done, but it has its limits. Often it's not practical to be applicable in enough situations, or the signal can't be jammed to a desired extent, which is why sometimes attacking navigation satellites themselves is mentioned as means to an end. But how doable would that be, and what repercussions might it have? This video will show it on the example of the Russian GPS-like system GLONASS. What would it take for said system to be disabled? Why interceptions with missiles and energy weapons aren't a viable option? How might interceptions by other vehicles in orbit be performed? Finally, how might finances and sanctions impact demanding projects like satellite navigation constellations?
Hey, what is this? A cute Binkov plushie?
Well, I guess I could use an adjutant. Come here, little fella, I'll take you home. And you too can take your own Binkov adjutant.
Available at Crowdmade store.
Yep, we made a Binkov plushie. If you want one, for yourself or as a gift,
do check out our Crowdmade store.
The link is available below in the video description. It's not too small, not too big, perfect for your desk or your shelf next to your military history books. Or you can give it away. We've made it as low cost as humanly possible, which is very hard when you're contracting very small production runs. Well, go ahead and treat yourself.
GLONASS was originally financed and devised by the Soviet Union. Today it is used both by civilians and governments. And of course it is used by the Russian military as it wages war against Ukraine. So if one wanted to get rid of the satellites altogether or to disable them, how would that be achieved? One method that has been tried and tested, though not against such high-altitude satellites, is using interceptor missiles. The US had a small missile system launched from an F-15 in the 1980s against low Earth orbit satellites. Usual targets would have been recon and communication satellites, orbiting at a few hundred to several hundred miles. In 2008, the US launched an SM-3 missile from a ship against an old satellite. While a bit larger than the 1980s missile, SM-3 is launched from sea level. It doesn't have the luxury of its first stage being a supersonic F-15 jet. The SM-3 is sometimes touted as the best US anti-satellite weapon, simply because there are hundreds of those missiles around, and there are dozens of ships' launch platforms around. There are no official ranges given, but the Pentagon did at times release some SM-3 trajectory depictions. An article for Breaking Defense news site had at one point offered their interpretations of those trajectories, providing range estimates. They suggested the vertical range for early block SM-3 missiles is little over 500 kilometers in altitude. The newer 2A block, which was then only in development, can reach 1400 kilometers up. Those figures are enough against low-flying recon satellites, but against much higher-flying navigation satellites, they're simply inadequate. Figures given were against ballistic missiles, so if a satellite doesn't change its trajectory, it's plausible a bit more vertical range could be squeezed out, but not much. Coincidentally, SM-3 Block 2A is very new. Literally only 66 were procured so far in total. But that's all beside the point. Even if it can somehow reach a satellite orbiting at 1500 kilometers or even at 2000 kilometers, that's not nearly enough. Satnav satellites usually orbit at much higher altitudes. Now, breaking free of gravity is hardest when you're closest to the Earth and when you're still fighting through some air resistance, so reaching a 10 times higher altitude doesn't require 10 times more thrust. But higher orbits do require bigger rockets, and carrying more fuel does get less efficient. Which is why the SM-3 Block 2A, even though it's a visibly thicker missile than Block 1, still doesn't offer significantly higher reach. The only US ABM interceptor that might conceivably reach GLONASS satellites might be the GBI missile. It's a missile developed for the Global Mid-Course Defense System, but there are just no figures available as to what altitude it can achieve. Roughly speaking, it may be enough to place a kill vehicle, a steerable object, high enough into orbit, but that's just a guess. Crucially, it's currently silo-based, and its silos are positioned to protect against incoming North Korean and maybe Chinese ballistic missiles. Chasing various SatNav satellites might require better positioned launch locations, especially if timely destructions are needed. So a whole mobile launcher system might need to be devised. And finally, there are literally only 44 of those missiles in existence. Using up missiles that primarily serve the anti-ballistic missile protection role, such as either GBI or SM-3 family, for attacking satellites, that's not going to be a credible long-term solution. It's not likely many would be actually used to go after various satellites. There are too few of them available as it is, and their main role is anti-ballistic missile protection. Now, what's more plausible than using ABM interceptors is regular space launch rockets, meaning commercial-grade space vehicles to put a kill vehicle into space, devised to deal with individual satellites. In 2023, US successfully launched 109 commercial and government-funded rockets into orbit, with most of those being large enough rockets to place a small kill vehicle high enough to reach a GLONASS satellite. The approach itself isn't outside of today's technology, and the US has claimed that both China and Russia have tested similar systems. Even back in the Cold War, the Soviet Union's most prominent anti-satellite system was based on exactly that approach. While it was used against lower orbit satellites, there is nothing preventing use of a bigger rocket to place the kill vehicle in a medium Earth orbit. The kill vehicle would then be guided towards the satellite, and for the final approach, it would likely use its own sensors to lock onto its target. Politically, there's nothing in place banning such moves. There's the Outer Space Treaty signed in 1967, which both the US, Russia, and China have ratified. But that only forbids nuclear weapons in orbit. There is no actual agreement on other weapons in orbit. Recently, the US and Japan put forward a UN proposal to reaffirm the ban on nuclear weapons in orbit and to ban development of nuclear and other weapons of mass destruction, custom tailored for space usage. Russia vetoed that, and a week later made a draft of a new resolution, which calls for a ban of all weapons of any kind in space. Some US claims about the possible Russian anti-satellite system mention it could be nuclear-based, but in reality all that is secret-level stuff. No one in the public knows. What is telling is that all the claimed tests launched so far were against low Earth orbits, so those are not likely to include systems that can threaten navigation satellites. But treaties and bans are in the real world just words. Those can change. Another political issue of attacking GLONASS satellites is more acute. The US and Russia are not at war. Despite the war in Ukraine, despite the sanctions, US seizing Russian financial assets and various US aid to Ukraine, the US is still holding a clear line of not actually attacking Russian systems. Attack on satellites would basically be equivalent to US attacking Russian aircraft over Ukraine, or even over Russia directly. But let's assume the US does go to war. Would it still go after Russian satellites? As long as Russia doesn't start that first, it's not really in US interest to escalate into space, as the US currently has far more satellites and its forces and weapons rely on sat navigation far more than Russian forces and weapons rely on their sat-nav signals. So if the US killed Russian GLONASS satellites, there would be retaliation, and it's plausible Russia would be able to at least reduce the US GPS satellite fleet. But then what? Both sides would have a backup system. The US could rely more on European Galileo, and Russia could rely more on the Chinese Beidou constellation. So without expanding the war even further to include other countries, neither side would likely gain an upper hand. Chinese anti-satellite capabilities and also replacement satellite launch potential is also much more robust than Russian one. It would pay more to the US to try to keep the status quo there, rather than to escalate the war into who can shoot down more satellites and who can launch more replacement satellites. It's one Pandora box that the US likely doesn't want to open, setting a precedent by going after another country's satellite first. So what other means are there to threaten GLONASS and such navigation satellites? Lasers are sometimes mentioned against satellites, but generally that's in the context of temporarily blinding low-orbit optical satellites. Power required to actually burn through stuff and damage satellites would be much higher, and that's for low orbit, mind you. Damaging satellites in medium orbit could require orders of magnitude higher outputs. 100 megawatts might not be unheard of. It might also require not so practical large mirrors for the lasers, possibly well over a dozen meters in diameter, to deal with beam divergence and power constraints. Basically, the technology is not there yet. Even much more modest military lasers are having issues being fielded, and various laser programs are years in delay. While dazzling of optics in low Earth orbits is likely doable and is even tested today, frying medium orbit navigation satellites is plausibly a decade or two or five away. What other options are left then? Can satellites be made useless just by jamming? Here we're not talking about jamming the sat-nav receiver on a plane, vehicle or a missile. We already covered that. It's doable to an extent, but can't always be relied on to work in a satisfactory way. But can one jam the signal coming out of the satellite? In a word, no. Jamming signals simply doesn't work that way. Sat-nav signals are explicitly one way and they don't depend on any input signals. They're basically just insanely accurate timed data pulses. However, in theory, it might be possible to hijack a satellite using only radio signals. If one manages to obtain access codes through spies and if one manages to mimic the input signal, then it would be possible to tell the satellite to move, to deorbit and destroy itself. But that's James Bond level spy stuff. Access to military satellites is basically as closely guarded as access to nuclear launch codes. In practice, it wouldn't happen. Hacking even one satellite would be regarded as a direct attack, so politically it's also not viable. So with all that said, just how can navigation satellites be neutralized? Well, US and Chinese ones are hard to deal with, but Russian GLONASS system does actually have an Achilles heel. And it's not what you think. Just kidding, sort of. To have a working global constellation with some sort of a useful accuracy, 24 satellites are needed. If Russia wanted to cover just itself in neighboring regions, for example Ukraine, 18 satellites would be needed. And while dozens of satellites have been launched since the 1980s, they have a fairly short lifespan before their orbit decays. That really applies to all satellites in a way. Now, early model satellites were different and they generally had just a few years in them. Some didn't last even a full year. By the mid-90s, average lifespan did increase to some 5 years, give or take. When finally a whole new generation of M-model GLONASS satellites came in the mid-2000s, lifespan started increasing to over 10 years. Officially, expected lifespan for M-models is 7 years, but most satellites managed to hold out longer before using up all their fuel to keep their orbits. K models are newest, but have also been long in development, becoming the predominant model launched only from 2020 onward. Right now, 24 satellites are active, with 2 more in testing. That's at the threshold for a quality global coverage. But 4 out of those active ones were launched way back in 2007. Those are M model satellites. They have been working now for 16 years instead of their 7-year projected lifespan. Basically, they can cease operation anytime now. 2 more satellites were launched in 2009, again well past their expiry date. 4 more in 2010 and 2011, and so on. Basically, the number of active satellites inside their projected lifespans is 8, plus those 2 in testing. That's not enough even for the 18-satellite strong regional constellation covering only Russia. While it's unlikely all those satellites will just die overnight, there's a chance most will cease operations over the next several years. So knowing all that, let's get back to the launch table. One can see that launches got really sporadic at the turn of the decade. We're basically at just 1 launch per year now. That rate is in the long term unsustainable. Besides the 24 satellite minimum, usually more satellites are desired to serve as backups. GPS has more, and Chinese Beidou has more. If an article by Pavel Luzin published by Jamestown Foundations is to be believed, Russia seems to be having issues with sourcing components for their advanced K-model satellites. Sanctions and inability to get their hands on all the required electronics may be part of the reason why Russia hasn't launched so many replacement satellites lately. Russia was cutting corners and using imported electronics. and unlike commercial-grade stuff in drones and even sometimes in missiles, some of the electronics for satellites can't be that easily replaced. Sure, Russia could develop its own stuff, but that might take time. Importing from China seems more plausible in the short term. That may be around the corner. Up to 4 more GLONASS launches have been announced in advance by the Russian Space Agency to happen before the end of 2024, but whether that will indeed happen remains to be seen. Another interesting development are various announcements during 2022 when Russia and China were said to deepen their cooperation with regards to both GLONASS and Beidou. Russia may have seen the financial issues coming even before the war. In early 2021, a plan was reported to eventually add 6 more specialized high elliptic orbit satellites. Those orbits would enable Russia to have some sort of regional coverage with far fewer satellites, meaning a cheaper constellation to upkeep. It may have been an off-ramp to transition from a costly global system into a combination of a regional one plus cooperation with China on their global system. What's really gonna happen is yet to be seen. GLONASS satellites, like any other SatNav system, are not very vulnerable, but lack of finance and especially lack of technological components and industry to deliver such components, now that can be the real killer. And remember, Binkov may talk about war, but only real peace can bring us all together.